morning, everyone. It's great to welcome you here to the clean, open deserts instead of the heart of pulsing Cairo. We're very sorry that we couldn't have kept to our original venue. I think you can probably all understand why a week ago when we had to make that decision, it seemed prudent to be able to have a calm discussion for 3 days, to be a little bit further from Tahrir Square than the gates of AUC happened to be. My name is Barbara Ibrahim. I'm director of the Gerhardt Center for Philanthropy and Civic Engagement. I know that that's a mouthful, and we're looking for an acronym who will win a money prize if you come up with one that works better for us. And this is the second year that we sponsor the TEPEFA conference to really shine the spotlight on empirical research, theoretical and conceptual work that helps us to underpin the amazing on-the-ground civic and citizen action that we're all seeing taking place before our very eyes. You've come to Cairo, those of you who are joining us from abroad, at a time of great turmoil, anxiety. I don't think I need to tell anyone in this room that we're about to have a presidential election in less than a week. Kind of choices that have been made available in this first pre-election to Egyptians have not lived up to the expectations or the hopes of many of the young people that brought us this revolution. There's a feeling that older and more organized elements of the society have captured this first national democratic process. But I'm finding that a great antidote for that kind of despair or depression is to just get out a little bit beyond the spaces of politics and national dialogue and Twitter discussions, to find out what's really going on across North Africa, in Egypt, in Libya, and in Tunisia, in the places that are actually now in the midst of their transition moments. And there you find that this concept of civic engagement, I have to tell you, 5 years ago when we founded the Gerhardt Center, people thought was a little bit off the wall. You know, why a center on civic engagement in the Arab world that really doesn't make a lot of sense? But it's becoming front and center right now in what characterizes the second phase of the Arab Spring in these countries. So in a place like Libya, where forming a non-profit organization had been criminalized by law. You had in places like Benghazi, within a month of the liberation of that region of Libya, 250 registered organizations of citizens beginning to address problems, build institutions, think about the new Libya that they hoped to see. The same thing in Tunisia. There had been slightly more space for civic participation, but there's an incredible flowering of civic participation, and we are delighted to have representatives from both of those countries who will share with you empirical research on what's happening these days. And even here in Egypt, where, as we all know, there's a long history of civic engagement and philanthropy, where we had 20,000 odd organizations before the fall of the Mubarak regime, there's something new happening. And it's not on all of our radar screens because it tends to be informal. It tends to be happening at the level of neighborhoods. It tends to be happening in the middle class, among poorer people in their own communities. It's no longer the purview of the wealthy and the well-attached to get involved in public life. And that's, again, the kind of thing that we're really hoping to shed a spotlight on in the next 3 days. At the Gerhardt Center, we have a research unit, and I'm delighted this year that Shanine Tadavulsi, who is our manager of research, took up the task of being the chief organizer of this conference. She's done an amazing job. Those of you who've dealt with her, worked with her on your papers and your presentations know that. Above and beyond that, she's also been very agile, and we needed to change a lot of things last minute and did it all with calm and poise, which I appreciate a lot. A year ago, at the first TEPEFA conference, which was held in Amman, we were at the beginning was a conference in which the interesting findings of a collection of about 30 different research papers began to ask us to do a better job of defining what is civic, what is political, where are the lines that are being redrawn as these societies enter into their first experiments with democracy. The panels that we held on the relationship between faith, giving, and civic participation were particularly exciting. Myriads of ways in which good Muslims and good Christians across the region are using the motivations of their faith to really build new institutions and to really make changes at community level and now increasingly at larger levels as well. We need to make those distinctions more clearly. We need the empirical grounding that enables us to say something to the journalists who have a much slicker take on things sometimes. And finally, I was happy to see in our first conference the beginnings of an effort to think theoretically and conceptually about our field. It has been one in which practical and the applied and the immediate often took precedence over understanding theoretically how what we saw on the ground was linked to a larger body of social movements, research, other social science that is helping us to build an understanding of the social world. I think you're going to find in this year's conference a real jump forward in the conceptual theorizing about where we are. And so we're very excited about this year's group of papers and presenters. We're delighted that some of you made the efforts to join us up here on the Hill, and we promise you a set of very, very exciting reflections as we go forward. I'd like to now introduce Shinnie Ntadebosi, let her talk to you a little bit about the program and what we have going, and then talk to you about our two speakers.
Thank you, Barbara. To begin with, I would like to highlight the fact that this would not have been possible without a stellar team that works in the research unit. Really, I have to thank Christine, Knight, Michael, and everybody who's really been working very hard over the past period to pull this together and under very different circumstances. It is very difficult for us at this point to dissociate the professional from the political, from the personal. And at this point in our history, as Egyptians, it is very, very heartening to see people who can pull something like this together with protests happening and all of that. So I have to thank my team. The other thing is that GiveWorld is a platform that aims to bring together both practitioners, academics, media professionals, in order to discuss the latest trends in philanthropy and civic engagement happening within the region. So much has happened over the past year. There have been so many shifts happening. And during my travel to Libya, I've managed to get a first-hand experience of some kind of unity that is developing across the Arab region, unity of vision towards change, towards democratization, but I've also sensed with burgeoning civil society. And that poses a lot of questions that we should be addressing seriously in the conference, which is, what is to be done with this energy of philanthropy and citizen activism? How can we best gear it towards impact on the ground to make sure that those activities are sustainable in the future? Those questions are very important to be posed, especially at a time when now we cannot say that we're new or novice when it comes to philanthropy in the region. The necessity of putting our ideas and our hopes into practice has become very present, it's become a reality. The honeymoon of philanthropy is really over. We cannot afford any more to merely reflect, but we need to think of ways whereby we can put those ideas into practice and make sure that we're thinking concretely about these things. Last year's conference touched upon a lot of issues, interface between faith and philanthropy, different types of civic engagement happening within the region. It featured a lot of papers that were really trying to tap into examples of corporate social responsibility, here, the highlight is really to look at things comparatively, looking at youth civic engagement across the region. We have papers from Tunisia, we have papers from Libya, from Egypt, that address this issue. The other thing is also looking at philanthropic practices and how to take philanthropy from merely an idea of charity to more strategic giving in very concrete terms. Those and many more of those ideas are going to be discussed across the conference over the upcoming 2 days, 3 days, really. The other thing is the need to take from reflection into action. And I think this transition is going to happen by the active involvement of our audience. So I strongly urge all participants to be thinking as the papers are presented about methodology, about the theoretical part, as well as the practical part. Our keynote speakers manifest that transition, or that mingling of reflection and action. We have a keynote speaker, Raja Masraoui, from Tunisia. Unfortunately, the Gerhard Center keeps its promises all the time, and we really tried to keep our promise of bringing Raja to give a keynote speech. However, as a result of the visa issue, which she found out about yesterday at the airport, she could not make it. Raja Masraoui is a human rights activist, human rights lawyer, and has been a staunch advocate for human rights under the Ben Ali regime. At the heyday of autocracy, Raja Masraoui was really fighting for human rights and fighting against torture in her hometown and she is a member of the Tunisian Bar Council, the Tunisian Human Rights League, the Tunisian Association of Democratic Women, and also a member of Amnesty International. She is the woman who said, "People have to kill me to shut my mouth. My life is about human rights." She is a manifestation of being able to reflect and understand the principles of human rights and also taking them into action. Now, in spite of the fact that Raja could not make it, we managed to get a video of her, which we are going to show in the next 15 minutes. And then, somebody else who is a very distinguished public figure, who has kept us company over years through the media, and who has led, in so many ways, a revolution, an awakening in media that was in parallel with another awakening happening in the Arab region. Dr. Hafez Al-Mirazi is professor of practice and director of the Kamel Atam Center for Journalism Training and Research at the American University in Cairo. He is the founder and general director of Al-Haya Satellite Television Station in Egypt. And he was also the Washington Bureau Chief of Al Jazeera and host of its weekly show from Washington. He will be delivering the speech right after the short video that we will be watching right now.
أمام مقر الولاية ويلكم يا رجال الهمامة أو محامية أو مثقفة ومبدعة أو موظفة، وكانت تحمل هم الشعب بأسره مطالبة بالحرية والكرامة والمساواة والديمقراطية والعدالة الاجتماعية. وفي يوم 14 جعفر، وهو اليوم الذي سقط فيه بن علي، كانت نسبة النساء في التجمع الذي تم أمام وزارة الداخلية بالعاصمة للمطالبة برحيل الدكتاتور عالية جدا. وهذه المشاركة النشيطة في الثورة ليست غريبة عن نساء تونس، وقد كنا حاضرات في مختلف مراحل نضال الشعب التونسي في الحقبة المعاصرة. فنساء تونس شاركنا في مقاومة الاستعمار الفرنسي طبعا، وشكلنا الجمعيات والمنظمات لمقاومة المستعمر والمطالبة في نفس الوقت بالإصلاح الاجتماعي. ولم تكن دعوات خريج جامعة زيتونة المصلح الطاهر الحداد في عام 1930 إلى إقرار المساواة بين النساء والرجال بما في ذلك في مجال الإرث من فراغ، بل كانت تعبيراً عن حراك اجتماعي وسياسي تقدمي كان للنساء دور فيه. وكان لذلك انعكاسه عند قيام دولة الاستقلال، وقد كرست قوانين الدولة التونسية منذ البداية إصلاحات هامة لفائدة نساء تونس، وقد ضمنت هذه الإصلاحات في مجلة الأحوال الشخصية الصادرة في 13 أغسطس 1956، والتي ألغت تعهد الزوجات وأقرت حق المرأة في اختيار شريك حياتها وفي الطلاق، وفتح المجال أمام النساء رغم الطابع الدكتاتوري للنظام الحكمي للذهاب إلى المدرسة والجامعة واقتحام أبواب الشغل على نطاق واسع بما في ذلك امتهان الطب والقضاء والمحاماة. وخلال الفترة البورجيبية التي امتدت من 1955 إلى سنة 1987 والتي تميزت بالاستبداد، شاركت النساء في كل المعارك السياسية والاجتماعية والثقافية التي خاضها الشعب التونسي من أجل الحرية والديمقراطية والعدالة الاجتماعية. فما من محاكمة سياسية للتنظيمات السرية التي بعثت وخاصة اليسارية منها إلا وكان فيها نساء، وما من حركة اجتماعية عمالية أو طلابية قمعت إلا وكان فيها نساء أيضا، وما من حركة حقوقية أو ثقافية إلا وكان من روادها نساء. وقد تشكلت في هذا الإطار جمعيات ومنظمات ونوادي نسائية ليس للدفاع عن حقوق النساء فقط، بل أيضا لتطويرها وتحسينها وسيادتها في وجه القوى الغلبة المتصاعدة التي كانت تدعو باسم الدين إلى العودة بالنساء إلى الوراء في كافة مجالات الحياة. وفي عهد ابن علي لم تتخلف النساء عن المشاركة في النضال ضد استبداد نظامه وفساده، رغم أنه حاول بكل الوسائل توظيف قضية المرأة لتلميع صورته في الخارج والظهور بمظهر النظام العصراني الحداثي. لقد رفضت النساء اتخاذ قضيتهن ذريعة أو غطاء لضرب الحريات وانتهاك حقوق الإنسان تحت غطاء مقاومة التطرف الديني. ومن ثم شاركت النساء في كل النضالات الاجتماعية والسياسية والحقوقية التي ستؤدي إلى اندلاع الثورة التونسية. وقد برزت نساء الحوض المنجمي بشكل خاص في عام 2008 في الانتفاضة الشعبية. بداية تكريس القطيعة بين الشعب التونسي من جهة والديكتاتورية المغامرية من جهة ثانية. وقد تبعت هذه الانتفاضة المحلية انتفاضات أخرى مشابهة في عديد المناطق إلى أن دقت ساعة رحيل بن علي. إن مشاركة النساء في الثورة كانت متنوعة، إذ شملت مختلف الأوساط، ولكن العنصر الأبرز هو مشاركة النساء من الأوساط الشعبية في المسيرات والمظاهرات والمواجهات مع قوات القمع، وسقطت شهيدتان وعدد من الجريحات، كما تم إيقاف عدد آخر من النساء. ولم تكن هذه المشاركة النسائية في الثورة من أجل إسقاط الدكتاتورية بشكل عام فحسب، ولكن المطالبة الخصوصية للنساء كانت حاضرة أيضا. فالمساواة التامة والفعلية كانت من المطالب الأساسية في الثورة، فالنساء يريدن استكمال حقوقهن على المستوى القانوني لنيل المساواة مع الرجال، كما أنهن يريدن النزول بتلك المساواة إلى أرض الواقع لردم أو على الأقل لتقليص الهوة بين القانون والواقع المعيش، وهو ما جعل كل القوى السياسية الفاعلة تقريبا بما في ذلك حركة النهضة الإسلامية تعلن تأييدها لمبدأ المساواة بين الجنسين، وقد هيئ لذلك ما سبق من اتفاقات بين تلك القوى في إطار هيئة 18 أكتوبر للحريات التي ضمت قوى يسارية وإسلامية وقومية وليبرالية، والتي توصلت إلى إصدار وثيقة مشتركة يوم 8 مارس 2007 يتعهد فيها الموقعون لا فقط بعدم المساس في مكتسبات النساء، يعني منع تعدد الزوجات، حق المرأة في الشغل وحقها في تولي كل المناصب في الدولة مثلها مثل الرجل إلى آخره، بل كذلك بالعمل على تطوير هذه المكتسبات وتدعيمها قانونا وواقعا. ولا بد من الإشارة إلى أنه خلال الحملة الانتخابية للمجلس الوطني التأسيسي ظل التمسك بمكاسب المرأة الشعار الذي ترفعه كل القوى، ولكن بعد الانتخابات التي أفرزت فوز حركة النهضة الإسلامية بأكثر من 40% من المقاعد بدأ خطاب البعض يتغير تزامنا مع بداية تحرير الدستور الجديد لتونس. ففي حركة النهضة تعالت أصوات للمطالبة بالتراجع في بعض المكاسب من بينها التبني، ولأن لم يجرؤ هؤلاء على المطالبة بالتراجع في منع تعدد الزوجات، فإن بعضهم اقترح تغيير الصبغة القانونية ليحذف منها التجريم بدعوى أن الأمر يتعلق بحرية شخصية. وفي نفس الإطار هاجمت نائبة عن هذه الحركة الأمهات العازبات، كما أن وزيرة المرأة وهي نائبة عن حزب المؤتمر من أجل الجمهورية الذي يتزعمه الرئيس المؤقت وحليف حركة النهضة حاولت تبرير الزواج العرفي معتبرة إياه حرية شخصية، وهو ما يفتح الباب لضرب مبدأ مدنية الزواج، يعني إجراء الزواج أمام مؤسسة مدنية ومنع تعدد الزوجات. وفي نفس الوقت سعى بعض من رموز حركة النهضة إلى فرض اعتماد الشريعة مصدرا أساسيا أو وحيدا للتشريع في تونس، وقد تم ذلك خلال المناقشات الأولية للدستور. خارج المجلس التأسيسي وخارج حركة النهضة أيضاً وفي هذا الإطار حصلت مشادات ومواجهات عديدة حول مسألة لباس الخمار والنقاب، ولكن كل هذه المخاطر التي تهدد مكاسب المرأة تمت مواجهتها إلى حد الآن بقوة من طرف القوى التقدمية والديمقراطية الحزبية والجمعياتية التي تمكنت إلى حد الآن من كسب هذه المواجهة. فقد تراجعت حركة النهضة عن إدراج الشريعة في الدستور، كما أن الحديث عن تعدد الزوجات خفت بشكل كبير، وعادت حركة النهضة ذاتها لتأكيد تمسكها بمكاسب المرأة التونسية، واعتبرت مسألة الخمار والنقاب مسألة شخصية لا واجبا دينيا يفرض على النساء بالقهر. واضطرت النائبة النهضوية إلى الاعتذار للأمهات العازبات، كما اضطرت وزيرة المرأة لتصحيح موقفها من الزواج العرفي متمسكة بالزواج المدني كما هو منصوص عليه بمجلة الأحوال الشخصية. إن المعركة التي تخوضها الآن القوى التقدمية بما فيها التنظيمات النسائية تهدف إلى تحقيق المساواة التامة والفعلية بين النساء والرجال ودسترة حقوق النساء، وهي تستند في هذه المعركة إلى مبادئ الثورة التونسية. فهذه الثورة قامت على مبادئ الحرية والمساواة والكرامة والديمقراطية والعدالة الاجتماعية، وقد اتسمت بطابع شعبي ولم يرفع فيها أي شعار ذو طابع ديني، ولم يطرح فيها تطبيق الشريعة كمطلب من المطالب، بل إن حركة النهضة ذاتها التي وإن كانت عرضة للقمع في عهد بن علي فإنها لم تدعو إلى الثورة ولم تساهم فيها كحركة، بل إنها ظلت داخل البلاد خاصة تراقب تطور الأحداث خائفة من أن يحملها بن علي مسؤوليتها، أي مسؤولية الثورة التي حملها في نهاية الأمر لليسار وللقوى الديمقراطية، بل إن بعض رموز هذه الحركة دعا بن علي ليلة سقوطه إلى أن يقوم بدور المصلح ويحقق ما جاء على لسانه في آخر خطاب له، بينما كانت غالبية الشعب التونسي تدعوه إلى الرحيل. إن المعركة لم تحسم نهائيا لفائدة النساء، فالمخاطر ما زالت تهدد حريتهن وحقوقهن رغم تراجع القوى الرجعية، ما من شك أنه من الصعب العودة بنساء تونس إلى الوراء، لأن بعض المكاسب التي حققناها أصبحت جزءا من ثقافة الشعب وهويته. ونقصد هنا مثلا خروج المرأة إلى الشغل والتعليم ومشاركتها في الحياة العامة وتقودها لمختلف الوظائف، واختيار المرأة لشريك حياتها والزواج الأحادي، ولكن الانتكاسات تبقى ممكنة دائما وهو ما يدعو إلى اليقظة. وفي كلمة، فإن الصراع حول حقوق النساء هو جزء من الصراع بين القوى المتمسكة بتحقيق أهداف الثورة وبين القوى التي تريد الالتفاف عليها بمختلف الطرق. وهذه القوى ليست في الداخل فحسب، بل ثمة قوى خارجية وخصوصا خارجية تعمل على إجهاض الثورة التونسية حتى لا يمتد صداها إلى الوطن العربي بكامله، فلا تكون نموذجا للشعوب الأخرى. ومهما يكون من أمر، فإن ما ستحصل عليه المرأة من حقوق في الدستور الجديد لتونس، ما سيطرأ على حياتها من تغيير سيكون معياراً لمدى نجاح الثورة التونسية، لمدى تخلص المجتمع التونسي من الاستبداد الذي يمثل اضطهاد المرأة مظهر من مظاهره. ودعوني أختم بالقول بإمكانكم وبإمكان النساء العربيات وكل قوى التقدم في الوطن العربي أن يثقوا بنساء تونس وبقدرتهن على كسب المعركة من أجل حريتهن وحرية المجتمع التونسي ككل. إننا واثقون بالانتصار، وشكرا لكم.
We thank Claudia Lafroy, even though she's not here physically present, but she's here in spirit, and I know that she wanted to be here with us irrespective of anything else. Now I give the floor to Dr. Mirazi, and I have to thank him for stepping in at very short notice, so thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you, Barbara, for inviting me, who was supposed to chair a panel that yesterday we learned about the really bad news about the visa issue, because that should be part of the best, especially from the free or the newly free countries or politically liberalized countries in the North Africa, particularly Egypt, Libya, and Tunisia. However, I don't know if Shireen or Barbara know or not that they want someone to be in presence in place of a Tunisian speaker. So let me tell you that my kids are half Tunisian, half Egyptian. They are grown-ups and living in the U.S. They were born there. And for them, actually, they insisted it's not half-half. One third, because they are Americans as well, and it depends on the priority which one is first, and it's really relying on our relationship. So when the Egyptian was left at the very end, I know there is something wrong. And although during the revolution in January 25th, really, they felt so proud about it. On January 14th, they kept calling me and reminding me that their first third in the Tunisian war. And then, luckily for me, I was saved 11 days only later. I realized that it's the Egyptian that is the first part of their identity. So, in any way, it's good news. And actually, I was in Tunisia. I did go there immediately. Actually, on the 20th, about less than 1 week after the ousting or the freeing of Ben Ali from Tunis, to cover what was going on in Tunis. I felt that the story has to be told with some kind of analysis and background, not just the news and the images and the repetitive street protests. At that time, I was working with Al Arabiya satellite channel doing a show called Studio Cairo, out of Cairo. And we did this kind of coverage under from Tunis for about 1 week, actually, from the 20th to the 26th. I returned back on the 27th to Cairo, to Egypt. And it was amazing, really, what happened in Tunisia and how to translate that to it. And what struck me, actually, was a conversation I had, not during one of my daily life shows from there, but was with a Tunisian leader who was imprisoned during Ben Ali era. For 20 years, he was a Nakba activist and one of the leaders who stayed in the country, didn't leave, and he was in prison for 20 years. His name is Gurimi. And after we finished, actually, sometimes you get the most important things after the cameras are taken off and you don't have anyone. So he told me, how is maybe you wouldn't expect me to use Marxist references given my Islamic background, But I am sure, as a political science student and researcher myself, he said Karl Marx predicted the revolution to happen in Germany, and it did happen in Russia. And here, we all in the Arab world, all intellectuals and activists, predicted and expected and was almost sure that it has to start from Egypt. It will be in Egypt, not in Tunisia, not in any other place. And look here, and he was so proud about it, that the revolution is in Tunisia, not in Egypt. So I remember telling him that you have to remember one thing in order to excuse Karl Marx or give justification for him. At that time, there was no Al Jazeera in Europe or any satellite TV station to transfer the news from Germany to Russians in order to feel that they were really the ones that they were supposed to revolt and rebel even earlier before the Germans. And that's really what happened in the Arab world. 11 days only later, once the satellite coverage of Al Jazeera, Arabia and others ignited the bomb, the real big bang of the revolution in Egypt to take place and to happen. And I returned to Egypt, to Cairo on the 27th, on Thursday. Sorry for not turning off my that could have been an excuse for firing a guest out of the studio. But anyway, I'm glad I'm not a guest. So what happened, I came back on Thursday night, and we all felt at that time that something is going to happen in Egypt and to take place in Egypt. And my show at that time was supposed to be every Friday out of Cairo. Once the revolution started, it became a daily show. So I sent some reporters to look for activists to organize the 25th protest in Tahrir, and to find out what do they plan to do on Friday, in case on Friday itself we can't reach them and things would be very difficult. So give some background from the studio in Cairo to what's going on. So they, one of them told me a nice story, that they set up everything. I mean, he kept chasing them from one building to the other. They keep changing, as if they were expecting the state police to be after them. And they were putting the plans, how to move, how to maneuver, how to deceive the police and the anti-riot police, and the orders and instructions for all of them. In most of these plans that we did interview them the night before the Friday of the Wrath, Jum'at al-Ghadab, on the 28th, which was the decisive day in which the police state collapsed by the end of the day. They told everybody, in case they interrupt the communication, we cannot reach each other, because they almost knew that this is how the others are going to react. You gather in each mosque around close to you after Friday, and you don't move unless you have at least 1,000 protesters with you, so you can overwhelm the concentration of the security police and apparatus in different areas around the Tahrir Square, and we're going to meet them. So the plan was put, that's very important for me. So when they cut off internet, cell phones, all of that, it didn't matter. For them, they already knew that and they know what to do. So for me, I think, coming from the background of TV, I felt that the difference here between what we call social media networks and what became now as traditional, I mean, when I started working with Al Jazeera in 2000 in Washington, they used to call us the new media. I mean, now if you say new media, we don't talk about satellite TV. It's traditional media now, and new media is the Facebook, Twitter, and the internet, and the social media networks. So the satellite TV station enabled and empowered Arab citizens, whether in Tunisia or in Egypt, to have the freedom of speech, to the flow, the free flow of information, so it cannot be impeded by the adherence on the borders of each country. And that was very important. But what was more important and the combination of it made the difference is actually the internet, because it enabled them and gave them back another freedom and right that they were denied, which is the freedom of assembly, to organize together. So without the freedom of assembly being regained in the virtual reality, in the cyber, cyber space of Facebook, whatever kind of places that we meet with and gather with each other and organize what to do. Without it, that was very important to know. We wouldn't have this kind of revolt or revolution or uprising, whatever you would like to call it. And I believe that's very important for us here to carry. If we're talking about philanthropy, activism, and youth activism, why I'm saying that is actually if we look at the background of people coming from the internet, those kind of young activists in Tahrir Square or in Tunisia, and we heard Radia Masraoui mention the fact that the uprising and the revolution started not by the Islamists, not by Dinahda or Muslim Brotherhood, they came to support later on. There is sleeping cells that they were under oppression, because we can, in the meantime, blame it on them as if they were collaborating with the regime and they didn't want to participate. But the fact that they wanted to save whatever left of them after years and decades of oppression, they were not the ones who initiated the rebellion and the uprising. But what is more important is the background of those youth activists who were empowered and knew each other through the internet. It's more mainly secular, civic background, not Islamist. And that's also something that is very important. Before that, the only place was not virtual, was a physical place where they could meet and have some kind of sanction from the oppression of the police state, which would be the mosque or even the church for Coptics who are activists, and they had to go to the church to get this kind of protection. And that allowed this kind of a religious background, that being a little bit, most of the activism in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, we have this background of Islamic background, or Islamist religious background, because the space where they can do assembly and meet each other usually are religious space. While we see with the help of the internet that they have a background of the secular one, and that's important. Of course, there was an Islamic background and the agenda enforced in everybody by the satellite TV stations, and particularly in my view, Al Jazeera lately, that wanted to put it in an Islamic framework or background. Why do we care about youth activism, and why it is important now, especially in this conference and in the Tekafel? I believe we need to look at the youth activism and activism in campus. As an example, when we wonder where those people did go and disappear, why all the social clubs in any campus and university, the student union, and all the activists that we did know as classmates, as colleagues, colleagues in the same school, where did they go? In the environment of political oppression, those people did just mingle in the society or became part of the fringe, radical, very radical ones, in order to survive extreme measures against them. While in the case of liberal and the new environment that we're looking for, we have really to look into how to empower them, how to keep them in the process. And it doesn't matter for me whether the process is political parties, charity, NGOs, union, as long as those people are still in as activists, and their energy, that's very important. And we have an example for that. Those people who survive and still one way or the other for later stages, you have Hamdin Sabahi and Abdelmenem Abu al-Futuh, who they mean, or one of them mean at some point front runners, depending on the before or after the first phase of the presidential elections. You have Hamdin Sabahi with a secular background, the Nasser's background, stay in touch and became number three, and one of the people that we believe, if allowed to get into the coming elections, he could easily win in this kind of election. And the only background is activism during campus, during the young one. And actually, between that and until this moment, there is nothing of practicing or anything like that. And someone really through the physician syndicate of the union, he managed to continue in touch with philanthropy, charity, helping in Pakistan, Afghanistan, and all of that stuff. And that was very important, although it is not considered really, or it doesn't, is not taken seriously as part of the experience that should, that he should be credited for. I would like to move from this one into two other ones that front runners now, Shafiq and Morsi, and the issue of fundraising and philanthropy and charity. We have to tackle the issue of fundraising, whether we get Ahmed Shafiq as someone perceived as presenting the old regime, then people are worried about that more crackdown and restrictions on fundraising, charity, and accusation that this is part of the supporting terrorism and what we consider the U.S. or Western agenda, after, particularly after 9/11. And if we got Morsi in this case, we have to talk about the kind of legislation and in order to ease the restrictions put on fundraising and all of these kind of activities. And we have to be careful during the next few months into this kind of debate, one way or the other, because we have to be very careful not to allow any one of them to use it for political gains, and to focus on what we want. What we want is to empower NGOs, the civil society, and not to allow a political party, whether to deprive the Islamists from fundraising or charity as a tool for them to recruit people for their own sake and developments, or the other one in order to justify more of crackdowns and making people stay away from any kind of suspicious activities that they would put them in troubles. And I think that is very important issue that we have to be. The last thing is related to media, actually, and I would like to give some attention to it. When we talk about charity and fundraising and philanthropy in media, I have a problem with this kind of what I call sometimes speaking audience or viewers. I mean, sometimes people reach the people in the media and say you need to help for charity causes and all of that stuff. And I believe we have to distinguish, the same way that we need to distinguish in politics, mixing charity or philanthropy with politics, whether it is coming with agenda of political influence coming from regional perspective, whether it's from Gulf states or from the West, or within internal players, Muslim Brotherhoods or others, the same way for media. We should not exploit the misery of people in order to make drama or soap operas and good TV to just attract advertising and all of that stuff. And we have witnessed that in Egyptian TV stations, whether state TV or private TV, the use of the misery of people in slums or poor people and people deprived from medical assistance to their children or peanut and trying to pick and ask people to donate for them. I don't think this is not what the media should do. The media should focus on the awareness of the big issue and the large picture of what do we need to do, what kind of tax regulation or tax bills that we need to push in order to allow this kind of help, what to do in order to do the issues of social welfare. All of these issues are supposed to be done by the media, but not in order to do it for this kind of exploiting misery. The other one is also fundraising on TV for campaigns for, I would say, celebrity projects, in which you choose only one hospital with all respect to what they do all over Egypt or two, and say, and get all the celebrities in the society, in the region, all of that, in order to ask people to help for that one. This is a wonderful and a noble cause, but unfortunately, this is not the issue. So this is something when we deal with the media, and my advice, and we have to do more on that, that how to get out of this kind of a simple coverage, whether you get someone who needs some kind of a kidney transplant or whatever, and they need some money and to be with them, or to just use it for rubbing shoulders with the celebrities and the rich and all of that stuff, and as if this is an excuse that you did your part. I think both are not. And I ended with the empowering local media. Egypt is actually today in the parliament, they are discussing a new bill on for the media. And I believe without empowering the media and local media, without having three or four FM radio stations, particularly community radio, and terrestrial TV stations in every city in Egypt, without it we cannot have a real media as it's supposed to be, instead of this kind of very little advertised based or initiated TV stations with some talk shows. This is not the future that we look for. And when you have this kind of small TV stations and FM radio stations in all cities in Egypt, let's make it 10,000 or 20,000, and it's easy to be done in 2 years. Once you have legislation to end the monopoly of the country of all frequencies, all the radio frequencies are nationalized. Once you give that and empower that, you would replace the social media network on the internet that we talk about and made it change visible in Tunisia and in Tahrir Square. You would carry that in all villages and cities in Egypt, because with the illiteracy that we have in Egypt and this high rate of illiteracy, you cannot carry this kind of discussion and empowering and using the spirit of volunteerism and all of that stuff without this kind of a local media. I think that's very important. I would like to thank you really for that, I appreciate it, and unfortunately I was planning to do it in Arabic in order to show you that I can speak Tunisian accent as well as Egyptian. Thank you very much.
I'm wondering if you would be willing to forego what was only a 15-minute coffee break to allow us to have a little bit of time to engage either with the ideas that we heard from Katia or Professor Hafez. Is that the coffee and tea are over there? People can simply get up if they need to. But let's take another 10 minutes. And really, what makes Tech happen, which I think is because we engage and allow for dialogue. So if that's okay with folks, who would like to?
Hello. Very well. My question is about campaign finance right now. Were there laws passed for campaign finance? What were they? And what is the role of finance, you think, in the final results, the first round we saw? If you could just generally sort of talk about the situation for campaign finance in Egypt, I think that's a very important topic.
Well, we have it just as a cap for how much a presidential candidate spent on the campaign, which was supposed to be 10 million Egyptian pounds, like with 1.7, how much would that be in dollars? We are in around less than 2 million US dollars. But there is nothing about the cap on each individual, how much, and that's what matters really, as I would say in your question, and this is something that even in the US we have been struggling with in order to reform the campaign finance, in order at least to respect, to regain respect to the democratic process, not to say it's just an oligarchy kind of rule. Unfortunately, we have two problems here, even with the very little restriction that we have on the cap, that there is no commission or anybody in order to enact it, in order to monitor and make sure that they are not spending on their campaign more than the 10 million Egyptian pounds that they are allowed. And everybody making a joke out of it, because we know for sure that just by someone like me working in the media, I know that the TV ads for both the candidates right now, Shafiq and Morsi, each one of them exceeded. The runoff should be much less. I believe it's three million Egyptian pounds, not more. But I am sure they exceeded that just for TV ads, let alone billboards and all the other stuff that they do. And the most really dangerous one is the there is no cap on people to do, no distinction between corporate and individual, because nobody really cares about it. But let's hope that we can do it in a shorter period than what it took or is still taking in the US to give you a pro regime. Someone trying to find excuses, but there is no excuse, and we hope that next election, and part of the reason for the lack of someone to enforce that is that until now we haven't had a constant or permanent commission on elections that for elections to monitor.
I want to say something about Dr. Razia Masraoui's presentation, even though she's not here to respond in person, but I would be happy to take questions from you and communicate them to her, and then in turn she would be responding to the participants. Yes.
لدي في البداية ربما ملاحظة لما ورد في مداخلة الأستاذة رضيا المصراوي، ثم لدي سؤال إلى ملاحظة الأستاذ حافظ، مع جزيل شكري للمداخلتين يعني العميقتين. الملاحظة الأولى، ورد في مداخلة الأستاذة رضيا المصراوي بعض التخوفات عن مستقبل المرأة التونسية، ورغم أنني أعتقد أن هذه التخوفات مشروعة، إلا أنه أعتقد أنه يعني المسألة تبعث على التفاعل، لأنه يعني كما ذكرت لي مكاسب المرأة وحقوق المرأة في تونس أصبحت جزءا من ثقافة الناس، ثم أيضا مسار الاعتداء الذي يوجد في علاقة التونسي بالهوية يبعث على الحصانة ومدعاة إلى عدم الخوف وإلى ربما إلى عدم التشاؤم كثيرا. هذه الملاحظة الأولى. بالنسبة لسؤالي للأستاذ حافظ، بوصفكم مراقب لهذا المشهد الذي يعني نشاهده اليوم من مشاركة الشباب ودوره في العطاء الاجتماعي الشباب المصري في مشهد المشاركة والعطاء الاجتماعي. إلى أي مدى يبعث المشهد اليوم الآن؟
طبعاً لي مخاوف، أنا لي رأيي الشخصية الحقيقة بالنسبة للموضوع الحريات والحقوق للمرأة. اللي ممكن أقول إنه قد يبدو غريب من وجهة نظري، لكن أنا في رأيي إنه يجب إنه نعطي حقوق بدل ما نحرم. بمعنى هنا في مصر في موضوع الأحوال الشخصية في فصل ما بين الدين، يعني المسلمين لهم أحوالهم الشخصية والزواج والتعدد والطلاق، المسيحيين كمواطنين مصريين الكنيسة بتحكم. أنا أعتقد ده بيقلل من مدنية الدولة، مش بيدي حقوق المواطن. الواجب المواطن نفسهم ليهم زواج مدني، كلهم يحتكموا إلى نفس القاضي، وفي الزواج الديني اللي الواجب يكون. بمعنى إني أنا من الممكن أن أسمح في دولة فيها إسلام ومرجعية إسلامية إنه يتزوج أبو 4 زوجات، ما بتعتبرنيش راجع أنا ما عملتهاش. يعطيله أبطو 4 زوجات بقيود معينة لابد يبلغها عن طريق المحكمة كل واحدة منهن، مش عارف ايه، يتحمل انه طلاق بالضرر، انه اي زواج اخرى هو ضرر، مش محتاج تاخد كل حقوق كل الامور للمسلم وللمسيحي. ثم اذا كان المسيحي من حقه، اذا كنيسته ما سمحتلوش انه يطلق او يتزوج تاني او تالت، يبقى الكنيسة تمنعه يدخل عندهم. والمسلم اللي هيتزوج لو هي مسلمة وتزوجت مواطن مسيحي والمسجد بتاعها ما اتدخلهاش، دي مشكلتها مع المسجد، لكن اثنين مواطنين راجل وست اتجوزوا. أنا بقول كده ليه؟ لأن تجربتي في أمريكا إن أنا شايف إن كل الحديث عن الحريات، أنا شايف إن حرمان المورمون مثلا اللي ممكن ميت رومني يصبح رئيس أمريكا، أو المسلم إذا كان أبو أوباما، إذا كنت أنت بتمنعه من تعدد الزوجات وبتقول له أنا ماليش دعوة، لا أنت بتتدخل في حاجة حرية شخصية وتقول له لا روح أعمل عرفي، روح أعمل جيرل فريند وبوي فريند. أنا في رأيي إحنا بنلعب حوالين الموضوع. بمعنى إن الخمر مسموح في مصر وإنك ياكل خنزير والمصريين المسلم ما بيروحش ياكل. فده من معناه في فرق بين الإباحة وتشجيع شيء. لكن من أجل إنك توصل الدولة، أنا مش شايف إنه شيء يضر الحقوق المرأة في تونس، إن أنا أحترم برضه جزئية حد تفسيره الديني، إنه من حقه إنه مش إنه عايز كذا يظل هذه الحقوق. فأنا في الموضوع دوت شايف إنه لازم نوصل لمرحلة يعني صمت أجريمنت إن ده مكان ما ينفعش يصبح كده الصراع بهذا الشكل، عشان نعمل مواطنة مدنية. موضوع الظروف اللي هنا في مصر، أنتوا طبعًا محظوظين عن مصر في حاجتين. في تونس ان في طبقه وسطى عريضه جدا، النظام بن علي مهما انتقدنا لكن في النهايه النظام برضه بيساعد الطبقه الوسطى، وفي ما عدا ال3 4 سنوات الاخيره بسبب عائله زوجته اللي حصل فيها الفساد المشوع عندنا على مدى 10 سنين، لكن الطبقه الوسطى في تونس مهمه جدا وهي كفيله بحمايه الاستقرار، والاهم من كده ان تونس لم تكن دوله عسكريه. كانت دولة بوليسية لكن لم تكن دولة عسكرية، بن علي كان بوليسي، وزير داخلية، رئيس وزراء، نط على رئيس الجمهورية، لكن أقل دولة بوليسية. احنا عندنا دولة عسكرية والبوليس نفسه مجيش، يعني حتى الأمن المركزي اللي تابع للداخلية هو أصلاً مجند تابع للجيش. دي معركة صعبة جداً للغاية، ولازم نفهم إنه تجربة مصر تجربة غير عادية جداً، والتحديات فيها صعبة للغاية. طبعا انا متفائل بشكل عام وشايف انه مزيد من الحوار مع الناس هيؤدي الى شيء، واتفاق مثلا الاخوان المسلمين مع التيارات الليبراليه الاخرى على تشكيل الجمعيه الاساسيه، ده متقدم بالنسبه للتيار الاسلامي عندنا عن النهضه، يعني النهضه اللي جايه من الهجره ومن بره ومطروده وما لهاش مكان في البرلمان، واحنا عندنا الاخوان المسلمين عندهم مكان في البرلمان وعندهم قوة أكبر بكتير من النهضة، رغم كده إنهم يتنازلوا في الجمعية التأسيسية إنه ياخد 15 عضو فقط، أو كل التيار الإسلامي بكل ألوانه 50% فقط في الجمعية التأسيسية اللي هتضع الدستور، تجعل المصريين يبقوا فرحانين جدا بإنه الديبيت عندهم أكثر فايبرنت أكثر عن في تونس. ربما السبب اللي ساعدنا في كده هو نفس اللي انا بشكي منه، وهو وجود المؤسسه العسكريه. فيعني مش دايما يعني تكون وحشه يعني للدرجه دي.
I found that these are double standards and it takes from the credibility
of a media outlet, even for you as an audience, as someone getting the message. So the issue is not about nationalistic feelings that I wanted to show the owners of Al Arabiya or Al Jazeera that you cannot buy me and Egyptian back in the 60s of Nasser, we don't serve you, don't whatever. Maybe some people got this, but no, it's about whether you are doing in Cairo, in Egypt, on at the AUC, and you say for AUC, I'm not going to accept politicizing anything. The same way that I had rejection for my campus or university to invite a Sha'ir and the generals of Al Adli and the police state on the 25th of January 2010. And I don't accept also that professors start to activate their students and ask them to go for one cause or the other. That is not, I mean, there is a difference between healthy politics in campus, but for the management itself or professors, if you go one way or the other, that's not acceptable. One yardstick. And that's the same for the media. I know your frustration with that. That how come that the same people who were campaigning for Mubarak in 2005 and also for Gamal Mubarak just a few months before January 25th of 2011 are now the people who are preaching and telling us what is not enough and how come we need to change and all of that stuff. It makes people feel they're getting, I mean, mixed signals and get confused and doesn't really believe in the media. And this is something that is going to take time, which first of all, we need to know about the time, the relationship of those people with the police state before, what did they have, all of that stuff. This kind of disclosure, we are still in an interim period, and it would be too harsh whether to evaluate the media or to evaluate the political system in Egypt or even the parliament. It is too early to do that because we are still in the midst of it. And I always remind people and tell people that we talk about January 25th as if this is the day of doing the revolution. And now, what did they do? What revolution brought to me on January 25th? I tell them, remember the 4th of July or Independence Day in the US. That was not the day of independence. This is the declaration of independence, that the intent. From now on, we are not going to accept colonialism and people imposing taxes on us and we cannot project our will. And it took them 8, 9, 10 years, even until 1813, when people came back to burn the nation state as colonialists. But the struggle is part of it. The same for the French on the July 14th and for the rest. So as long as we keep that in mind, that we are still in the revolution, whether in Tunisia or in Egypt, we don't have a problem. Of course, we celebrated the ousting of the head of the regime, but we are still struggling with parts of the regime, and hopefully we will overcome, or we shall overcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mirazi, and we have to wrap up and break for a coffee for 5 minutes and then convene again. I would like to thank Dr. Mirazi and Raja Nasrawi for both their presentations. They touched upon very important issues, how women and gender dimension of the revolution is really becoming the locality in which a lot of the forces fighting the movement politics are taking place. And Dr. Mirazi shed light on the role of media in the revolution and also with a lot of forward thinking on the shifts happening going forward.
Shireen, there's no such thing in Egypt as a fighting of poverty.
It
just
believe me,
So I would suggest, if you don't mind, that we just exchange places, have the first panel ever come forward, and anyone who needs coffee quietly get it.
Okay, thank you.